Hello and welcome to the installation learning video for the Cerberus FIT fire detection system. In this lesson, we will explain the installation of a Cerberus FIT system. We will explain how to mount the Cerberus FIT fire panel, how to wire the panel, how to wire detectors and other field devices, and which additional documentation is available to support you in the installation process. So, let's get started. First, let's check how to mount the fire panel. After unboxing, open the door of the panel using a screwdriver. Break out the required cable entries and screw cable glands into all open entries. The cable glands are not included. The mains cable must be fed into the housing on the right from above. The signal and control cables can be fed into the housing through the remaining entries. Next, mark the position of the top mounting hole on the wall. The recommended height of the display is between 1.60 m and 1.70 m. Drill the hole and insert a dowel matching the wall material. Attach the panel to the top screw and mark the bottom mounting holes by using a spirit level. Drill the holes and insert dowels matching the wall material. Fasten the panel using screws with a diameter greater or equal to 5 mm. Finally, put the supplied aluminum stickers on all wall mounting holes. Now, we would like to show you how to mount the accessories. The evacuation module, the LED indicator, and the key switch are mounted the same way. Detach the blank plate by lifting the four clamps and push it off the person-machine interface, also called PMI. Insert the new module by pressing it firmly into the slot of the PMI until it clips in place. For the evacuation module and the LED indicator, connect the flat cable to the port on the back of the PMI. The key switch has to be connected to the dedicated key switch port on the back of the PMI. If you would like to add an output card to the panel, use the four screws delivered together with the card and mount it next to the mainboard. Connect the flat cable to the mainboard and wire the 24 volts connection to the power supply. The modules RS232 and RS485 are mounted directly on the mainboard. Connect the module firmly into the plug on the mainboard and secure it with the screws. When the mounting of the panel and the accessories has been completed, start wiring the panel. Please ensure the correct polarity for all connections. Switch off the mains supply, AC 230 volts, and connect the mains cable. Then, connect the signal and control cable. After that, let's go on with the detector line. Connect the detector line to connector A. In case of a loop topology, connect the returning line to connector B. For the FC362, follow the same steps for the connection of the second loop. Please keep in mind that a maximum of 126 devices can be connected to the detector line. The next step is the connection of the sounder lines to the sounder line outputs. Each line must be terminated with an end-of-line resistor with 2.2 kilo-ohms. The current of each sounder line is maximum 0.5 ampere. For both sounder lines, the maximum current is 0.5 ampere in total. The panel mainboard has also four configurable inputs and outputs. Each one can be configured as an input or as an output. Connect 0 volts and the I/O if it shall be configured as an input. Connect 24 volts and the I/O if it shall be configured as an output. If it is configured as an output, the maximum current of each output is 0.1 ampere. The maximum current of all four outputs is 0.2 ampere. The panel mainboard contains three relay outputs used for controlling without line monitoring. These relay outputs can be freely configured as fire control, remote transmission fire, remote transmission fault, and fire alarm. Connect the normally open or the normally closed outputs and the common connector depending on your requirements. The output remote transmission fault is closed as an inverse function in quiescent mode. In case of fault, the contact opens. The maximum current of each relay is 2 ampere at 60 volt DC. If an output card is added to the panel, connect the outputs to the card. Each line must be terminated with an end-of-line resistor with 2.2 kiloohms. In addition to the default monitoring for short circuits and open circuits, the outputs can be configured to monitor the output lines for creeping open circuits and creeping short circuits. For more information on this option, take a look at the technical documentation. The current of each output is maximum 1 ampere. The total available current of the four outputs is maximum 2 ampere. The RS232 connection depends on the printer to be connected. For the use of the Fujitsu DL3750+, the terminals are connected from the RS232 module to the DB25 male connector as follows. Terminal 5 to pin 7, terminal 4 to pin 2, and terminal 2 to pin 3. For any other printer, connect the corresponding terminals. The connection cable has a maximum length of 15 meters. If the RS485 is used, connect terminal 4 to the A line and terminal 3 to the B line from the RS485 module to the participant. Terminate the line after the last participant with a 120 ohm resistor and use shielded cables. As the last step of the panel wiring, connect the batteries. To do so, secure the batteries with the cable ties delivered together with the panel. Next, let's take a look at the connection of the field devices. In order to wire the CNET, use a twisted 2-wire cable with or without shielding. We recommend using unshielded cables as it simplifies the installation and there is no need to remove the shielding. Please make sure that the cable type used complies with local regulations. First, wire the detector bases. Connect the negative and positive poles to the corresponding terminals in the detector base as shown in this graphic. The external alarm indicator can be connected to the terminals 1A and 6, and it can be configured how the indicator is activated, either alongside the detector's internal alarm indicator, using a zone alarm, or using an independent control. Each base is equipped with a loop contact, that means a continuity switch. This continuity switch ensures that the loop remains unbroken when the detector is removed. All other field devices have a screw or clamp terminal for the loop connection. Make sure not to mix up negative and positive polarity. And now we will go on with the connections of the I/O modules. The inputs of the I/O modules are monitored for open line and short circuit. In order to facilitate this, two resistors must be connected to the end of the input lines, as shown in the following diagrams. The FDCI361 and the FDCIO361 need a 680 ohm resistor and a 3K 3 ohm resistor. The FDCI222 and the FDCIO222 both need a 1K 15 ohm resistor and a 3K 01 ohm resistor. When a short circuit or an open line occurs on one of the input lines, a fault message is transmitted to the control unit. The inputs must be potential free. The outputs of the I/O module FTCIO222 can be used to activate control functions like closed door, for example. The outputs are potential free relay contacts. The outputs of the FTCIO221 and the FTCIO361 can also be configured as potential free relay contacts. In this case, make sure that the jumper is plugged into J1. It can also be used as a monitored output. That means the module switches the externally supplied DC 24 volt voltage to the output when it becomes active. For this, make sure that the jumper is plugged into J2. The last element which we would like to show you is the FTCI723. It offers one control input and can be configured either as collective conventional detector lines or as conventional X detector lines with the SP3X barrier. Connect the plus and minus poles to the correct connectors of the conventional detectors or the SP3X barrier. For further information on the installation of the panel and the field devices, please take a look at the technical documentation of the FC361 and FC362. In the next lesson, you will learn more about the commissioning and maintenance of the Cerberus FIT system.